Das Geburtstag Kind. La personne qu'on ne présente pas. So I switched to English, I'm sorry. So I saw Offer the first time. First of all, before I start, I'd like to say that Offer has been a very important participant in the Seminaire Variété Rationnelle in Paris over many years, and I'm immensely grateful to him for that. I met him the first time in Angers in 1979, where there was an intensive discussion between probably these two characters over the distinction between the Chateau Moreau's 1947 and 1945. There were a couple of bottles on the table, and Offer asked the right question: is there a difference between the yellow one and the red one? But in the meantime, he has left. And then after that, well, there was, I kind of remember one point when Suslin was lecturing on some theorem which has been mentioned, namely rigidity theorem for algebraically closed field, where there was a curve. So Suslin was lecturing, there was a curve, and this was 1981.
82.
1982. There was a curve involved. And so the curve was smooth and projective. So at some point, Offer started saying, well, projective not necessary. Smooth not necessary. Connected.
Ah, yeah, for connecting points by. Okay, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, remember this.
And then so in 83, he gave us a great help to Sansuk, Sula, and me when we were studying p-torsion in the char group and codamption 2 using the Ramvid cohomology and the crystalline cohomology. So he helped us an awful lot, probably doesn't remember.
No, no, but I think your paper was in 82. You started the preprint. The preprint, I remember that I met in Sansuk in his office around 82.
The paper was published in 83.
Okay.
Actually, the paper in 83, so I can tell a story about this. All right, I have 1 minute. So there was a diagram which was supposed to commute or anti-commute. So one morning, Sansuk would sing, would come up, lots of spectral sequences, Sansuk would come up saying, it commutes. Then the next day would say, it anti-commutes. At some point, we decided that enough is enough, it commutes. And then after the paper was published, 1 month later, we got a letter from Gabber. It was a map from CHI to HH2I. It minus 1 to the power I commutes. And then, let's see. And then I remember another story which is typical and which is generic of many things which all of us have experienced. In 1997, I was giving a talk on somebody else's work. And after 55 minutes of lecturing, there was a and then there was a flow of consciousness, as they say in English. And so, Offer told us many ways to fix the gap.
About the Saltman,
So it took us the whole lunch to understand what he was saying, but he was right, and he had several ways to fix it. Okay, and then we come nearly to the topic of the conference because of his talk, because in 2002 he showed me how to show that a certain cohomology class, which was non-ramified, was in fact non-trivial by spreading it out to some place where it is actually ramified. Yeah, you remember that one.
Is it in the thing with the
enseignement mathématique?
Yeah, but it published in 2002. But it was. I remember I discussed with you in TITS conference, in the TITS conference college. It was maybe. No, but the discussion with you was before. Yeah, well, it was in maybe 2000, 2001.
No, I don't know. The thing with TITS is another story, it's 2006. There's a story in 2006 where he managed to. So a paper was submitted, and there was a spreading out argument of field which you used to a function field of something of finite type of a spec Z, and it was a complicated argument reducing to the P adic and finite fields. And then Offer had me talking about this, and from the other end of the room, he said, oh, no, you replace this by a spreading up argument. You take the field and you embed it. Any field can be, characteristic zero at least, is algebraically closed in the field of cohomological dimension one. And that was enough to make a much better paper. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for the introduction.
I'm not spreading up. Spreading up for families of rigid analytic varieties, joint work with Brian Conrad.
Okay. So I thank you for the introduction and the organizers. So this is actually not a new, completely new thing. It is something that I discussed with Brian Conrad starting in 2014 in the spring after he heard talks of Scholz. In the MSRI workshop that I didn't attend where it was based on something I actually mentioned to Scholz, some ideas that I had about spreading out, and it was important for some arguments in periodic Hodge theory. And then I sent him some scan, and then anyway, it was I lectured about it here in the event for the Laboratoire Alexander Grothendieck, and also in Oberwolfach in 2016 in August. So this is essentially, so the abstract is actually just a copy for convenience of what I did in Oberwolfach, but the content of the talk will not exactly be the same because maybe I don't remember exactly and I did not, there are some notational, anyway, so so now some of this, so this work is actually quoted in the paper of Batmore Scholze on integral periodic Hodge theory. In fact, one needs less than this. So they want to prove certain things on, they work over algebraically closed non-Archimedean field.
So could you write bigger?
Okay, so you have an, okay, well, this is the eraser, or? So, there is a non-Archimedean. So, complete for a rank one valuation. So, it is, so we are, as usual, we are in the mixed characteristic. Zero p case, and we have some proper smooth either scheme or rigid analytic space. Now the case of scheme is easier than the case of rigid analytic spaces because for scheme there is a there are many results on the Talc homology. For rigid analytic spaces, it's there are equivalent definitions, like either using Berkovich or Huber's approach with adic spaces or Zariski-Riemann approach. In any case, there are comparison with the cohomology of schemes. Now, the in periodic Hodge theory, one is interested in several cohomology theories, like there is the Tal cohomology, the Deram cohomology, possibly the crystalline cohomology of the special fiber if there is good reduction. So, for the Rham cohomology, there is a well-known spectral sequence that converges to, so the Hodge to the Rham spectral sequence, which degenerates when we are dealing with proper smooth schemes or even Keller varieties or things birational to Keller, or certain class of, so over the complex numbers using Hodge theory, and actually it does not always degenerate for some bad smooth, I believe, for some, although I did not have time, but I believe it's, you need some assumption. In the periodic world one, does not need any assumption. So Scholz proved over, so in the case of discretely valued fields with perfect residue fields, one can, okay. So the question is to know whether this degenerates. In particular, it gives a quality of dimension. So originally, Faltings in his work on periodic Hodge theory, but of course he has the case of, I mean, it comes out from the theory that is coming. There is a kind of periodic approach to this, and also in particular, there are comparison theorems showing that the dimensions of a Tal cohomology is the same as the dimension of the Deram cohomology, and the question is to do it in somewhat more generally for, so Scholz did it over discrete So in the general, using the theory of perfectoid spaces. So, but this was in the more classical case of perfect residue field and discrete valuation, which actually helps. Actually, there is a finiteness theorem in general, which also gives some kind of Hodge-Tate spectral sequence, which involves HP X omega Q Q something omega minus Q, yes. Okay. So classic. So this is originates from Tate's works on pre-divisible groups, and then using the Galois action, one can see. Well, Tate uses the Galois action to get some results. Now, so of course, when the field is algebraically closed, one doesn't have any Galois action. So here, in any case, we are interested in the question. Just let us say for dimensions, the dimension of the Tal cohomology, which is known to be finite, in fact, also over Zippy, but Schultz as well. But it's the question is to know that it's the same as the dimension of the Rham cohomology and also the sum of dimension HP omega Q. So for this, it's enough to know. Oops. Like this. So there was also a theory of a kind of crystalline cohomology of X over something that they call B de Rham plus in this paper of BMS. And then this was a kind of a complex of B de R plus modules. So this specializes to the Rham cohomology, but you have to invert some psi to get to B de Rham, where actually then there is some comparison with a Tal cohomology. And so the question was whether this is a free BDR plus module. And so the result was that if X over C spreads out, and also there was some other argument, or there is a good reduction, then there was also another argument. So spreads out means then all the questions, well, one can answer all the questions. Well, then one knows all the facts that I mentioned, like the dimensions are right. So the spreads out is like this, that you have the field QP inside C. So what you want is a family of rigid analytic spaces, let us say proper smooth family, proper smooth, where Y is a rigid analytic, well, let us say classical rigid analytic space. Of course, you can always then pass to adic spaces if you want. So then you want a C point of Y, so that the fiber is the space that you start with. And so under the spreading out assumption, the idea is that one can use, for example, for the Hodge to the Rham degeneration, one has this family, one has the kind of the spectral sequence gives, so you have coherent shifts, and then you can specialize it some generic, sufficiently general point. Okay, so now, so actually in my work, I prove that this kind of spreading out exists, but in fact, for the application in question, to that is for the facts that are in this BMS work, one needs slightly less. It is enough to have some so enough to spread out over some discretely valued field F contained in C. because then you could also make the residue field perfect, and then the same arguments will work. You don't need it to be QP. And now this can be done using more classical deformation theory, but I will need it in a form which I don't know the references. Usually in classical things like Schlesinger criterions, comes the residue field is the same as the residue field of the Bayes ring somehow, but it is not difficult to see that the same statements hold. So I want now to review classical deformation theory just for, at least I will assert that certain things in the literature extend when you allow finite type residue field extension, which is not difficult to see, but I don't know exactly if there is a reference for this. So the statements in the, so in particular, there is Schlesinger, so-called Schlesinger criterion, and the classical reference for the case of stacks is Doxa and Rham in SGA7. And then there are other people like they, but I don't, I know that like there is log art in ring, but any case, there are, basically we work over, let us say R is a complete nœtherian local ring with residue field K. And so let us fix a finitely generated field extension. And then we consider the category C of Artinian R algebras with residue field given with an isomorphism to K prime. And then I have a functor from this to sets. And so there are several natural conditions on the functor. So I have f of first a. So if I have a fibered product of so of course, unlike the case where you are over small k, it is not clear in general that this fibered product exists. I mean, but in any case, I consider only fibered product where one map is surjective, and then there is no problem to see that it is still in my category. So this maps to FA1. And then there is also F of so in any case, there is one result about when F is representable, or F is pro-representable. So this is star by a complete nœtherian local ring over, so something in this with residue field K prime, if and only if
the object are local ring.
Local Artinian, yes. In fact, you can always think of K prime as the residue field of some point in some affine space over K, and then you can pass to the case of trivial residue extension by, okay. So it is probably represented with some condition, okay, that star is an isom, and then you need some finite dimensionality of the dual number thing. And then then there is a notion of a versal deformation. So, So a versal deformation is something like that the functor representable by some B going to F is surjective and satisfy the formal some formal smoothness conditions, so some lifting. So in any case, I will. So anyway, there is a classical criterion for which I claim.
You're reading for representable
or I mean, it is isomorphic to home from complete nœtherian local ring to your. So the Schlesinger criterion. Well, you need this to be an isomorphism and the tangent space to be. I mean, you apply to dual number over K prime. You can endow it with vector space structure. You want this to be finite dimensional. That's, and then you also want to know when there is a versal deformation space. So that's a slightly weaker condition. This is, well, this is a very classical thing. In any case, you assume that this is an isom and this is one dual numbers, and again the finite dimensionality. This is the criterion. And then in algebraic geometry, we work like flat deformations of schemes, shifts, and so on. So we have categories. So the case of stacks and groupoids then F is a pseudo functor and so this is the SGA7 case, so it is and then I want to have a smooth groupoid, so some formal spectrum of some B and then something, so I have a complete nœtherian local ring with residue field K prime over R, and then I want a kind of formally smooth equivalence relation. And so then you have a necessary and sufficient condition that star is an equivalence of categories plus finite dimensionality for, well, both the isomorphism, the set of isomorphism classes and for the automorphisms of the trivial thing, and then you, this is a, okay. So now, in the case of, so now let's look at the case of rigid analytic spaces over C. So we know that X over C comes from a formal scheme, a topologically proper formal scheme over OC, so adic and flat. In fact, so it corresponds to a formal scheme over those which are flat or finite presentation where pi is some pseudo uniformizer, for example, P. And then, so now the point is that in the cases that I work with the Sartinian thing, but instead I can work with not some slightly bigger rings, because usually the infinitesimal deformations are, so usually F commutes with direct limit of, I mean, this is the two limit of the categories. So, and then we have the residue field, so chi zero over, let us say, the residue field of C descends to a finite type subfield. And then, Okay, so yeah, so there is a finite type so there is some, let us say, ring of finite type over the integers, so that the model of mod p descends to R, and then you can localize R, and then you just a moment. Yeah, so this R, after localization, clearly the maximal ideal will give nilpotent elements, so you get Artinian ring. So it has some residue field which is of finite type. And now there is elementary, so the fact that this is an equivalence of categories in algebraic geometry is some some pinching argument, so you have to show that the flat scheme over a fibered product ring is the same as giving a collection of flat schemes with patching data for flat schemes over A1, A2, A3, which is not so difficult when the one kernel is nilpotent. So in any case, I will replace OC by this, so OC mod P, I will replace by this R, or R localized, and then I will have OC mod P square and so on, and then I will have the inverse images. So those are not Artinian, but kind of limit. So anyway, then one can pass to the limit and find I have some versal deformation space, so I map to by versality, I can extend successively the maps of the versal deformation space so that this comes from the versal deformation. Okay, so now so I have my. Yes? Yes?
Why do you need this finitely generated extension? I mean, is it not the case that modulo some small power p to the epsilon of p? The scheme.
Yeah, yeah.
Modulo p to the epsilon is somewhat constant?
Yeah, yeah. The scheme, yeah, yeah, it's true. So you can use instead of observing the localization of this as Artinian, one can do as you said, because you have the field certainly lifts to OC modulo some principal ideal, and then you can do the same thing with this. Certainly you are right. So you can just use this finitely generated field instead of R in OC modulo something, and then you don't have to write this p square or so. So
no, but can't you just literally use field K? Because, you can find this. You have this special fiber over K, and modulo some small power, it's already isomorphic to this constant extension.
Yeah, but I said before that it is not difficult to see that the classical three results in deformations for that is for representative versal and for the case of stacks, which are usually stated with trivial residue field extension, extend to the case of finitely generated field extensions. But of course, maybe there are also more general field extensions. The problem is that somehow it's implicit there that you are using things like the differential and the cotangent complex of finitely generated for this field. I'm not sure that there is.
I want to reduce the case where there's no field extension at all.
Okay. So, you want to so you can say that the vit vectors over the residue field map to the you can choose it in some way, yes, and then there is will be no field extension at all, because the you can choose. But this requires some. Yes, I know that I know that one can do it. Okay, but I did not. Okay, so so in fact it is not. Let us. But in any case, what I say works also for more general non-Archimedean fields. I don't need it to be algebraically closed. So, okay. So, so in any case, I have some. Some universal or versal deformation over some ring B, but then I can this is a finite type, so then I can pass to some DVR which is obtained by adding a transcendence basis of the residue field, and then this is finite, and then I have this. Complete. Okay. Then this is a kind of a special formal scheme in sense of Berkovich. So it has a kind of general fiber, and then you get a family of proper smooth family over the general fiber of this, which is the spreading out that you want. So now I want to have a more general. Spreading out result. So I want. So suppose now that x to y is a flat proper morphism of rigid analytic spaces over some non-Archimedean field, and I want to approximate the ring of integers by some nœtherian ring A. So it's could be like so I have just sum up a nœtherian ring complete with respect to an ideal I and an adic map to OK. Now so I know. Okay, so locally, you have a flattening theorem. So you have after blowing. So you have some formal models, and you can, after blowing up, you can assume that this is a flat proper map of formal models. So. Now I want to so I have the so I let us say that I have that y is a finoid, so I have like over spec O y modulo power of, so I have a family of schemes proper flat over this. So again, this descends to some finite type algebra over A mod I. So okay, so now I want to prove that the following. So let us say that I have an affine finite type morphism, and I have a flat family, so proper lattice. So I want to construct a compatible family of versal nth order deformations. So the power of the ideal. So so I want to embed T prime in something of finite type with the ideal killed by the nth plus first power of the ideal is zero, and extend the morphism to something flat over T prime. And so the so in particular, and then this will give me a versal kind of. So the idea is that you can define the notion of versal nth order deformation in the sense that if you have any family over and some nth order deformation, it is a pullback from the versal one, plus the, and also in a stronger form that if you give the map on a closed subscheme between T and T prime, then you can extend it in and with extension of the isomorphism. So then, so the main point is to construct a versal first order deformation, and for this, one is to look at the I, let's say I is an OT module finite type, and then I associate to this the category of X over T, say X1 over T1, where this is so I want to have a infinitesimal thickening with square zero ideal given by I, and the lifting of the morphism. So so this varies with I. So there is a notion. So in Grothendieck's first or the original. One of the first work on deformations was the lectures of Grothendieck on additive cofibered categories. So an additive cofibered category is a cofibered category over, let's say I have an additive category A, and I have some cofibered category over it, and I assume, so the assumption is that it commutes up to equivalence with finite products, including this. So zero is the one point and binary product. And moreover, if there is a notion of left exact when it is an abelian category, which means that C of a kernel of a surjection is the equivalent to, okay. Now the things coming from the deformation theory are easily seen to be additive cofibrid category as a dependence on I. And now we have okay, so for a complex, let's say, in degree 0 and 1, we associate, let's say, Q of this complex. So an additive cofibered category, which is as follows. You take home C prime X to home CX. So this is an object, let us say, in the additive. So this is a chain complex with two terms. And then giving this gives you what is called a strict Picard category, where those are the objects and those are the morphisms between, well, the morphism between two objects is something here that goes to the difference. And then you get a kind of a pseudofunctors to so you associate, so the category associated to this is the one associated to X now. So in the case of an abelian category, so the kind of the left exact additive cofibered categories correspond to two-term, well, are always represented by two-term complexes in the category pro C. Let us say that C is small to avoid the, so this is a category with enough projectives, and the complex in question is two terms where this is projective, and this ensures the left exactness, and in fact, you need slightly less. And now, we need some finiteness property. This is just, we need some finiteness property in the cases coming from algebraic geometry. So the idea is that you calculate using deformation theory, like the cotangent complex theory of Illouzi, except that we need some slight, some refinement. So we introduce a topos. The top, actually, we have in general, well, there are non-constant function. One is to look at this as a, so like the, this is a diagram of topos, the total topos. And so one is to look at the formations there. So something classified by R home of the cotangent complex and then pullback of I. And so, but also the usual way it was written, it just gives you the set of isomorphism classes. The isomorphism class deformations are classified by something. And so, in the course of this, there is some use of coherent duality. So if I have something like a proper flat morphism, let us say, and Y has a dualizing complex, is nœtherian, this is a dualizing complex. Let us say with the strong sense that is finite cool dimension as well. So it's like in Archon's book. So it so the duality exchanges d minus and d plus. Then you can look at so you can construct some kind of at least partially defined adjoint to F upper star by it's kind of the and so so that and then we have there is also a generalization of this to the case of the topos associated with a finite diagram and so this was also done by in some paper of Jack Hall several years ago, but we need the case of a topos of this diagram as a so and then if we one applies the yes, if one applies the only what is so just the statement of the deformation theory in the sense of isomorphism classes, one does not get that the additive cofibrate category is given by a complex. You only get that the functor set of isomorphism classes is isomorphic to what is given by this complex. Of course, there should be a way to refine it, and in fact, one can object by object refine it by being very careful about the constructions of involving the cotangent complex, but then you have to vary x. There is some higher categorical coherency thing. So the idea, one idea is to look at all, let us say, all x's, let us say, or all x with some size restriction and somehow put them together in a topos. I mean, with and I mean, we have a topos of diagram parameterized by this and work in this, and then one can, I think, refine the information. Although maybe now there are some techniques with higher categories that allow one to see that whenever things look like they should be coherent, they are coherent, which is implicit in various talks that are now heard, although the lecturers are not always willing to reveal the well anyway so instead of doing this so maybe I will I don't know if I mean it can take a long time to so anyway there is actually a trick here that you don't really know have to know it in the refined sense because you can demonstrate that if you know that the additive cofibrate category is representable in a weak sense, just then it actually, there is a versal object. So that's, I want to explain. So if an additive cofibered category C over A, let us say A is abelian, is such that the isomorphism classes of Fx is isomorphic functorially to cokernel, Hom, Qx to Hom Px, then where Q is projective, okay, then Q and the canonical map give a versal, no, a cokernel. P and the canonical map gives a versal object. So the surjectivity is clear. But the problem is that you have to know it in a refined form with a lifting. So I have got, let us say, x prime. I have some class over x prime, and it goes to, and I can represent it. Suppose it's already represented by a map from P to x prime, and then I want to lift this map to a map that represents, so I have some object, actually, a lifting. So the point is you can pull back by this, you can pull back and use the property that it sends, I mean, that you get a pullback square of categories. So you can assume that that x prime is p, and this is the identity map. Then the class alpha is represented by some map. But then the composition must be the identity up to something that factorizes through Q, which is projective. So you can correct, because Q is projective, you can lift, then you can correct it so that it is actually a section. But then you have an isomorphism, but I don't feel, so I only know up to isomorphism. So I know that my object here comes from this in some way, but then I get an automorphism over this. But now, since I can lift automorphisms because the object, this comes from this, so I can lift automorphisms and then I can fix it. So I get, okay. So now, after one does some, there are some technical work with toposes and then some technical work on defining successive nth order deformations, I mean, universal. So the idea is that once you have the nth order one, you want to pass the n plus first order one, but the n plus first order one is kind of a first order deformation of some nth order one. So you want to, you have something which is the idea is to take kind of some versal first order deformation and cut it down so that the ideal defining this, some product of ideal should be zero, and then you have to collapse something, because after you take this modulo the n plus first power, maybe you get slightly something bigger than this. You can retract it and pinch something. Then you have to prove that you don't have to pinch farther and it is still versal. So that's some argument that I did in 2014. Then, so after one knows this, one can generalize. So the rigid analytic description of, concerning the application to rigid geometry, so if x over y, let's say this is a topologically finite type of some OK, I can let's say I have my so there is some ideal of definition of A that goes to an ideal of definition of OK, and then I can see that this flat deformation comes from my versal formal. So this comes from formal schemes over SPFA, except that they are not topologically of finite type, they are more like special in the sense of Berkovich, but then you can still make some blowing up, reduced to topologically of finite type thing, and then you get a map of rigid spaces, like in the sense of Renault over A, so R, or in the sense of the book of Fujiwara Kato. So that's, and then you get, you, so for example, I want to prove that the Hodge to the Rham spectral sequence degenerates. So I want to prove that RPF lower star omega q are locally free and the spectral sequence degenerates. So of course there is a question, foundational question for which kind of nice, which kind of framework there is enough theory to speak about this question for. But at least I reduce, so one is to do some work with base change of coherent base change. But the idea is to reduce to the nice nœtherian case. And then you can actually use rings of finite type over Z, and then you have enough specializations, enough where are, or enough rig points, which are essentially coming from finite extension of QP. So this is in the case where the general characteristic is zero, but notice that I can also have residue characteristic zero, which is, this cannot be handled by just approximating OK by DVR in OK. So one has to really spread it out over Z and use some characteristic P, residue characteristic P specialization. So the proper smooth, so this is an analog of the result over C, which is proved in the paper of Thélène, that is that if you know for the fibers the information on degeneration, it shows by a length argument that in 69, I think, or in any case, it shows that this is so a comparison with Bethic homology, the spectral sequence degenerates. So here, one is, what? 60, well, it is the paper on the generation of spectral sequences. Okay. I don't, okay. Anyway, Grothendieck also mentioned it in Recall to Semi, that it's really, anyway, it's a. Okay, don't. So in any case, the idea here is that you reduce to the case of Artinian local rings, finite dimensional over QP, and so some family of rigid analytic spaces over this. And then the analog of Bethic homology would be to develop some kind of crystalline cohomology, like what Butmore and Scholz do in this framework. So you have to say that if you have a chi over SPR, so I have also chi, the special fiber of, okay? So I want to see that the Rham cohomology of chi doesn't depend, you also have a constant deformation. You want to show that the Rham cohomology of chi doesn't, is the same when you use a constant deformation. So the idea is you can do it by hand without any, you can just define the analog of crystalline cohomology by just using a small, I mean, like a fine cover or some cover where it lifts, and then you use a check construction. So you use a local embedding in something smooth, and the embedding of the intersection in the fibered product is known to the expert. So you take the formal completion in the Rham complexes, you make a complex of this, and with hyper cohomology if needed, if so things. Anyway, so you somehow can compare any two choices by doing both of them. You use some easy Poincaré lemma argument in characteristic zero, and then you see that this theory is well defined, and it depends only on the special fiber, and it gives the Rham cohomology of any liftings. In particular, the length is the same, and this allows one to use the Thélène's argument. And then this gives us that, at least in every context in which there are enough foundations for rigid geometry. So of course you need some base change so it's a question, I mean, which at least in the classical rigid case and the nœtherian case should be okay, but still one is to use some base change arguments. Okay, so this is the application which of this result. And then I also want to mention though the that the spreading out, it doesn't work. You need the proper rigid analytic space. It doesn't work for non-proper ones. And for non-proper ones, there are several ways to think about it. So the, in the manuscript, there is an example in characteristic P based on inseparability. So if it spreads out, then it is defined over a field extension of the, so it's always a base DVR, let us say. It's a field extension of, it depends over the completion of finite type field extension, in particular the finite P rank in characteristic P, and then the, you can, if it is not reduced, you can make it, you can, after a finite extension, it becomes generically smooth. And this is not true for reduced rigid analytic spaces in general because of infinitely many coefficients. So you can, but you can also make an example with, so for affinoids, they can be algebraized by Lkx, so they always descend to something good. So now I want to give an example of a non-spread out. So let us say that I have a base. So I want to find a large extension such that this is a non-Archimedean field. I want to find some smooth rigid analytic space over E that doesn't spread out to a flat family over K. So for this, I will take, let us say in characteristic node 2, I will consider over a disk cross P1, kind of I have double coverage, like a family of hyperelliptic curves. So this is the parameter z, so I have something like y square is equal to x minus 1, let's say a pseudo-uniformizer pi, then x minus pi square 1 plus z, x minus pi cube, let's say 1 plus phi z, where phi is some infinite series, is coefficients in E. So the idea is that for such an E, which is it slices over a disk, and the O of D is the ring of global function, the point is if it descends to some non-Archimedean field, then the ring of global function descends. Of course, it's not necessarily a disk, but after some finite type extension and closure, it becomes a disk, and then you need some finite detail extension, some finite extension to, well, you need cross ratio between branch points. I mean, you can also have, you can construct the hyperelliptic involution and the cross ratio up to some finite extension. So then you use the fact that you can make the so-called topological transcendence degree, there's several definitions, to infinite, because you can introduce infinite transcendence degree in the residue field here, and you get a contradiction. Or you can also, if the value group, you can also introduce infinite dimension of the value group, this value group mod this value group in these coefficients, and you can then see that you cannot reasonably, you cannot descend it to a small, you always need to any field to which it descends as a residue transcendence degree which is infinite, so it's, or the value group extension which is infinite, that quotient is infinite dimension, so it cannot spread out. So I guess, okay.
Questions?
You never need a B-square argument.
So in the first thing, so if I have it depends on the precise problem which you, so let us say I have a non-Archimedean field E and a subfield K, and I want to, but then I will need always, so the first argument doesn't give the spreading out to with a base which is a rigid analytic space over K. The best thing one can do is to adjoin some transcendentals. You have some Gauss valuation over K, and then you get it by the argument that I said. And what Scholze said is actually, in the case of algebraically closed, like CP, they know that you can lift the residue field. So the point is, you can just lift the transcendence basis, and then use Enzel, and I mean, you use and taking piece roots. I mean, you get let me see. I once discussed before this. Anyway, it is a non-point. I forgot now the it is not the classical successive lifting, because you need to first lift it mode. Let's see. Okay, you have FP adjoint some transcendence basis and separable closure. And then you use just piece root of some trans. I see how it works. So in any case, you can do it in a non-unique way, and then you actually can work over the V vectors of this perfect field. This is special to this situation. So, but in any case, there is a stronger thing that I said. But anyway, for the application to periodic Hodge theory in question, it's enough to use what he said. So.
When does a strange adjoint exist there?
What?
When does a strange adjoint exist there? What's the hypothesis on K?
Okay, so there is the following. Also, this is slightly. So this this funny adjointness also works with twisting by a relatively f perfect when the morphism is not flat, but you have an f perfect complex. And usually, I work. At least in the originally, I just make the K in D minus, L in D plus, E is bounded and F perfect. Then you can see that tensoring this actually introduces, but anyway, doing all of this still sends you to D plus. And then the assumption, so let us say you work with nœtherian scheme of finite Krull dimension, admitting a dualizing complex, and then one can make some argument which uses that the dualizing complex gives an equivalence between D, exchanges D minus and D plus, and is you need some unbounded complexes, but so the point is that this, it looks like that it should. So what I also, after I know that it exists, it.
So it exists in general, or what?
So I think it should exist without the assumption of dualizing complex and without nœtherianity if you have enough approximation technique. Also, maybe you can relax some boundedness assumptions. But, and I think that there is a part. So I didn't discuss all the deformation problems. Then you can do deformation of coherent shapes. So sometimes you have to use it for H1. So usually I get that this is bounded. I can see that this is bounded when K is in D less than or equal to 0. This is in D less than or equal to 0. In particular, you get something for just for home. And of course, the statement for home can be easily, by approximation, reduced to this case when it's nice. So then you can do more, not necessarily nœtherian basis, not. Nœtherian. Yeah, so I don't know the. So there is a paper of Jack Hall around 2000. Well, I saw a paper in 2013, I think, maybe. So now what we need is the case of finite diagram is the same thing, or at least the diagram we consider. So one has to work a little and see the similar effect hold. But I think now when people have this viewpoint of infinity categories and some general criteria for existence of adjoint in some whatever, you can see that this must accept that usually everything is.
Universal usually doesn't commute with pullbacks because, and with limits because there's some tensoring involved.
What? this, let me see. So you want that the core limits in K go to this.
You need that upper star takes limits to limits.
You need. Yeah, but of course here everything is coherent. So it doesn't, in this argument with duality, everything is coherent with some boundedness restriction. So one does not see those phenomena you are speaking about. But if you want to do it very generally, then first of all, this is in the quasi-coherent setup. So I'm not sure about yeah, so F upper star commutes with
co-limits.
With
co-limits, with star.
No, but this means that at least if you restrict yourself to with some finiteness hypothesis, you will get such a thing now. So of course, nowadays, maybe if you want to know what it means for unbounded things, maybe you have to work in some of Gatsguri's stuff where you take pro in and all kind of things that I don't know about, and then you always get something in which certain things hold, and then you can say that you. What?
Perhaps we should stay bounded.
No, but I'm saying that there are some talks where it's really important to understand the subject to have this theory I'm not saying that but I already heard it several years ago, and so I didn't study. I mean, so I'm still bounded in some sense, but okay.